action. And that was a barrier that goes to reality. And I think it's a reality that as an activist, as the activist in this organization, here in Vancouver and around the world, we don't shy away from that reality. We face it. And that requires two characteristics. That requires an intellectual development to be able to discern reality. It also requires the emotional maturity and development to be able to face those realities head on. Because we do have an impairment in both of those areas. And it's not one over the other. You know, so often we get hit with the left brain, right brain, and you know, oh, it's just a theory, but then other people talk about it. And you can easily draw a direct correlation between the left and the right brain theories and the left and right brain, or the left and right paradigm, easily, simply by the personality characteristics that are applied to both. It is not a one or the other scenario in order to move us into the future and out of this problem. So, what I'd like to go through, I'm not going to talk terribly long. It's going to be kind of a synopsis of a cadre school that we did a couple of years ago. And it's based on a paper that LaRouche wrote called What is a Humanist Academy? It's from the Old Campaigners. If any of you don't have a copy of that, let me know. I can get it too. LaRouche is a genius. I'm not going to go into his biography here. It would take too long. But LaRouche, if you read his writing and if you look at what he's accomplished, if you look at the way his mind works, he is a genius. But he's not like the geniuses that were taught about in school. Because he allows us into his thinking process. And then he tries to teach not information, he tries to teach how he's thinking. And what that does is it changes what you know to changing how you think. And how you think is actually primary compared to what you know. Both are important. The information that you have is important, it is vital. But how you process that information is actually what's going to get us to a higher evolution and to move into the future beyond this menticide that we're being inundated with. So LaRouche set up this organization not so that they could come up with solutions to problems alone. He had actually been working on this for quite some time. He spent this movement wasn't started until LaRouche was what, 50?
43 or 4.
He had spent a good portion of his life before he created this movement in manufacturing, in business. He was a business consultant. He had hands-on knowledge of the world, of business, of economy, of people, of how organizations work, of human behavior, and he was a problem solver. He was the guy that a big or small or medium-sized business would call in because they got a big problem on the manufacturing floor, and their numbers are down, you know, production is down or whatever, what have you, right? He was the guy that they called in. And he got some attention when he was applying his learning and discovery and all of his reading, his mind, to the national economy of the United States, and he had made a prediction, and he had caught the attention of certain people, the FBI, particularly at the time. Now, this movement has many functions, many purposes, but one of the main ones is to transfer that knowledge and to transfer not just knowledge and information, but to develop people's minds. That's the key thing. And so I'm going to go through a little bit of that learning process here. That's a long paper, and I there's no way I could do the whole thing justice. We may review it again this summer. But he goes through and makes a lot of correlations. And they're direct correlations between how our minds work, the outside world, our inside mind, and the processes that happen. And this is a direct quote from the article, from the paper. They knew that the reality of the lawful ordering of the universe was of the form of processes. Form of processes. The interplay of self-evident particles. Now that's just a snippet, so there's a lot more around that, but this is the most important part. And what he's talking about in they, he's talking about the Aristotelian school versus the Platonic school, and the two modes of thought. And you know, philosophy now is, Plato is done in the first class, you know, you maybe write a paper about it, and you know, they'd rather get into Kant and you know, the existentialists and the Hegel and all that stuff. They really spend a lot of time on that, and they just completely, you know, coat over what Plato has contributed to human understanding and human knowledge. So, what LaRouche goes through in this, and this is directly related to what Phil brought up in that, you know, what we're not being told is actually more important than what we are being told. It's important to recognize that what we're being told is a lie. You can't kind of move on from there if you don't first come to that realization. So where do you go from there, though? Because this is what we're finding. We're in a stage where people are rightly angry and upset about everything from the price of gas to the price of rent to foreign policy to foreign leaders and their own leaders lying to us on a regular basis. We are on the verge of a revolution, and that revolution is either going to be characterized by nonsensical and chaotic anger, or it's going to be directed to a higher form. That's why this movement exists. That's why the Society for the New Humanist Paradigm exists as well. So he lays it out. He lays this out. He lays a pathway for us to follow. He's not giving us the answers. He is allowing us to discover this for ourselves. So he characterizes these as kind of three levels of knowledge. The process of defining our reality, I would say that. Because that's what we're really doing. Like, human behavior at its core and its essence from our very beginning is to solve problems. Ask any environmentalist how to solve the problem of electricity or running water, and they can't tell you. Okay? The true believers. They would rather have us all in outhouses and, you know, with candles. Because that's the level of their thinking. That's not a solution. That is literally the level of their thinking. Okay? And that's been designed. So this whole lesson, this whole education has been sorely missed. And this is why we have news channels all over the United States and Canada repeating the same thing, and people go, oh yes, right? So he characterizes knowledge as N. So it's N, N plus 1, N plus 2. And these are the, I hesitate to call them, it's not a linear thing. It's not, you know, level 1, level 2, level 3. each stage goes into the next stage, which goes into the next stage, and it's more complex, and it's an evolution process. So the first level, for lack of a better word, is the knowledge is a reflection of reality, right? That poster is green and it has white writing. Okay, that's facts. That's information and facts. That's what it is. But it doesn't tell me that that's a message from the management of Douglas College to clean your shit up. Pardon my language. Okay? They want you to clean the room after you're done. So it's not, it is a description of the reality, but it's not reality in and of itself. Okay? And this is kind of the level that we're being taught, you know, through the media, through the news channels. I mean, there is zero imagination going on here. It's just input, output, input, output. N plus 2 gets a little better, N plus 1. This is the stage of rationality. There's some creative things going on here. There's some thinking going on here. You're looking at that sign and you're going, okay, yeah, I guess I better clean up after the meeting, right? Like, you're taking it to the logical next step. It's also, I didn't get into the green. Just ignore the green for now. But you're creating a hypothesis. Like, my bringing up that, you know, Douglas College wants us to clean up the room after, that's my creating a hypothesis, right? So that's where you're taking these information and facts and actually applying them to, you're internalizing it. What does it mean, right? And this can also be characterized, and this is also a very powerful tool of the oligarchy. This has to do with music, popular music. You asked a question about this before. This has to do with psychology. It has to do with mass media. It has to do with marketing. Advertising is the input can be conscious or subconscious. That input, right? So, but most often it's unconscious, preconscious. This is where the conscious comes in. So the conscious mind is creating a hypothesis. Sometimes if you're on high speed and you're doing a lot of things, sometimes you do this unconsciously too, you don't realize you're doing it, and then you turn around and it's like, oh my God, what was I doing? Right? Then you get to N plus 2, and this is the level of Platonic thinking. This is why we study Plato. Not to memorize it and regurgitate it, but to internalize it. And this is where we get to real creative thinking. And that is the hypothesis of the hypothesis, right? So my next hypothesis would be Douglas College, I think, probably had a problem with people not cleaning up their things, or they had, you know, some sort of internal, I mean, I'm totally guessing here, but, you know, we can guess that people were renting rooms and not cleaning up. By no means am I making any statement about us all cleaning up the room, by the way. It's not. It's just the best example that I have right now. Because it's always a thing. So that's where you're going at it. And this process in people's minds and their thinking process is completely missing from, and it's not encouraged, you know, you're being critical, not in a negative sense, but you're questioning what you're being told in a proper way when you get to this level. Now, in this paper, LaRouche makes a lot of correlative statements about these three things, knowledge, rationality, and reason, which are Platonic ideas, with inorganic physics. This is where Riemann and Leibniz's work is embedded in his economics. Inorganic physics, organic physics, and metaphysics.
Noosphere.
The noosphere, right. Yes. And I often say this, you know, when I'm talking to people online, you know, like, what they're saying isn't wrong. You know, it's not about like being wrong or right. It's just that it's not the whole picture. And we are constantly bombarded with, and it's from the time we enter school, with the process of compartmentalizing the information. And we're told that it's for efficiency, and sometimes it is. We're told that it's, you know, not everyone can know all this information, right? But you take a child and you teach them 3, 4, 5, seeing children that have been taught 5 or 6 languages, and by the age of 6 or 7, they know that many languages. And what a language does, and this is part of the Humboldt education style, this is part of the program that we are promoting, that we hope to get off the ground, is a Humboldt education. Part of that is learning multiple languages. I'm relearning Russian right now, which is great, and what I notice is that it really challenges my brain, not because of, you know, there is the input factor, but it's more so that it's forcing me to change the way that I think. And that's what reading LaRouche's papers has done for me as well, and I hope that I can do that for you. Because more so right now, we have a world of level N. And we have more level N now than we have ever had in human history. Think about that. I can Google anything. I can YouTube anything. And so often the complaint I hear is, in an age where we have the internet and Google and all the rest of this, and people are still dumb as shit, pardon me. Like, they're not putting it together, right? So what has happened? Two things. This is me speaking, this is my hypothesis. LaRouche mentions that right here is where the oligarchy with the exception of a couple of really evil people, Bertrand Russell being one of them, they do not have reason because they spend so much time manipulating the rest of us between these two. And, you know, I wrote in that article that, you know, they're in a recruitment drive because they have so dumb down their own people that this is not possible. Now Paul's going to be talking about this, but this is where Xi Jinping is. This is where Putin is. This is where Modi is. And the big question mark of the century, is this where Trump is?
That's, well, he doesn't know.
This is such a distraction. It's like as a swamp. It is like a minefield of disinformation and misinformation. I can't tell you how many times I was told something about someone else or told something about an organization or whatever that when I got in and talked to those people myself, I realized that it was half-truths and mostly mischaracterization. And I can tell you that the same problem is happening. I'm not saying you can't know. You can know, but you have to be able to sift through all of this stuff. And the question too is that if it's a process, perhaps he's that way right now. We don't know, but can we change, right? And we have to allow for change within our lifetime and going forward. So, that's dense. That's a lot of information. And we're gonna dig into this summer. On that note, I wanna make a special announcement. Has everyone got this?
No.
No? Okay. We have
decided or made a decision on our conference. July 24th, it's going to be at the Vancouver Public Library. Helga Zaparush is going to be keynoting. She's going to be the first speaker. We haven't confirmed one of the speakers, but we have also a confirmed speaker from the University of Washington. He's an Asian law expert. He's going to be speaking on the legalities behind the U.S. and Canada joining Belt and Road. We also have Paul, and Paul's going to be debuting our Four Laws booklet. Now, our Four Laws for Canada is based on the same one for the U.S. We don't have very many of these, but that's what we're currently writing, and this is what all of your contributions are going to. This is what spreading the word about our organization, about the Four Laws, is going to do. And so we're going to be, Paul's going to be giving a presentation on that for Canada, and we'll be debuting it there. So this is a very big event, and I wanted to make sure you all knew and mark it off in your calendar. Now, after the conference, we're also going to have another camping cadre, and that is going to be somewhere between August 7th and 14th. Clearly not the full 7 days, but it's going to be somewhere in there, and I'll get you the details of that. But I wanted to give you a heads up on that as well. So, well, we don't have time to get into like really in-depth stuff at this meeting. There's a lot to go over. I think this kind of gives you, a good flavor of the overall process of thinking and our purpose, our reason for being in terms of promoting the society and spreading the word about getting us out of this next conundrum and conflict that Paul's going to get into. So.
What was the campaigner title?
Humanist Academy.
The article is called "What Is a Humanist Academy?" Yep.
Thank you, Robbie.
Thanks, Robbie.